got so many things plugged in. I feel like I've just come out of surgery. Now there are seats, actually there are seats upstairs. If people want to come in upstairs, there's room. There are seats over here. The numbers are dropping, which is great. There's seats over there. So if you want, there are other seats. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If I have all the eloquence of men or of angels, but speak without love, I'm simply a gong booming or a cymbal clashing. If I have the gift of prophecy, understanding all mysteries there are, and knowing everything, and if I have faith in all its fullness to move mountains, but without love, then I am nothing at all. If I give away all that I possess, piece by piece, and if I even let them take my body to burn it, without love, it will do me no good whatever. Love is always patient and kind, is never jealous. Love is never boastful or conceited, is never rude or selfish. It does not take offense and is not resentful. Love takes no pleasure in other people's sins, but delights in the truth. It is always ready to excuse, to trust, to hope, and to endure whatever comes. Love does not come to an end. Mary, help of Christians.
Pray
for us. St. John of the Cross.
Pray for us.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Before I go on to today's talk and other things, that reading from 1 Corinthians should not make you sit there and think, isn't love wonderful? It should rather make you stop and think, if that's what love is, I don't love. And I believe that's the fundamental reason that St. Paul gives us that in the first to the Corinthians, not to tell you how wonderful love is, but to so prick your conscience that if you are impatient, you don't know the love. If you're jealous, you don't know how to love. If you take delight in someone else's faults, you don't know how to love. And rather than seeing as an eloquent statement of what love is, it's far more powerful as, I suppose, something you take when you go to confession. And you read it. I can't read that in prayer without feeling guilty. Because every time I read it, I know there's so much about love that I don't yet have. And the simple truth is, your bishop doesn't know how to love. He's not an expert in it. The expert in it is probably the Vicar General. That's why he's the Vicar General. But as for poor old me, I don't know. Okay, I want to briefly finish what we did last week, because I had to stop before the end of time. To bring in where, in fact, penance fits in, because you should have asked me, well, Bishop, what do you tell me about penance? Because I spent last week looking at what's technically called humility. And humility is that by which I'm able to see myself as God sees me. And that means to be able to identify my weaknesses and my faults, the truth about myself, and not be oppressed by the experience, but simply be able to live and love myself as God sees and loves me. That's why weakness and temptation is such an important topic, because it's the very thing that we find in ourselves which is not lovable. I didn't move on to penance, and I'll just do it very briefly now, because we're looking at prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, and fasting fundamentally is about self-denial or a form of penance. In my tradition as a discalced Carmelite, we would say doing penance for the sake of doing penance is an absolute and complete waste of time. In fact, St. Teresa would say great ascetical practices for no particular reason is treating yourself like an animal. So people look at Discalced Carmelites and think we're the ascetical branch of the order, but far from the truth, because penance and asceticism for its own sake, in fact, has to be the most stupid thing that you would do. It's a kind of criticism that's brought to Jesus. Why are your disciples doing penance? And he said, they would never think of doing it while the bridegroom is with them. Because penance and self-denial has its proper place. The man that we're going to look at this evening, St. John of the Cross, I'll tell you about who he is next week. But he has a wonderful saying. He says, don't do penance unless there's a reason. And what's the reason? Every day examine yourself, and for every fault, that means sin or inclination to sin, make sure you do a penance. Because asceticism, self-denial, and penance has its proper place within the context of a great whole. First part we looked at was prayer. We finished that as we looked at weaknesses. And we will look at the third part this evening, which is love. But penance and self-denial fits within the context of a totality. And if anything, the point of penance is to bring balance into your life. Because when you find fault, you in fact identify imbalance. Now that could be because of weakness, in fact things that you've done wrong. And when you recognize that, Carmelite spirituality says, then you need to do something about it. If the weakness is something that you should have done but didn't do, you need to do something about it. If it's about pride, whatever it is, the recognition of the fault or the weakness or whatever it is in myself, the recognition of the truth of myself leads me to have to do something. Therefore, if you do any penance in Lent, it has to be very carefully thought about and crafted to fit you. Okay, so get away from, I'm giving up lollies for Lent. What's the point of it? How is giving up lollies connected to your faults and weaknesses? You see what I'm saying? And that's precisely why you can go through 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 Lents and still fall back into the same things because nothing has happened. Because that season of penance which you've chosen to take on as a member of the church has never been done in such a way that it's for you. Okay, so you say, oh yeah, I'll give up this, I'll do this. But you've never had in mind while you're doing it the reason for doing it. And the reason is the faults that you find within yourself. As I put in my little Lenten message, pick one fault. Don't try to do them all, because you might spend the rest of your life struggling with one fault. But if you do that, the penance of Lent, if it can then pass over into an authentic penance of life, will bring about real change in you, will bring about true holiness, because the penance that you then do will be for you. Penance for penance sake is, St. Teresa would say, is for animals. It's and worse than that, you can think, I've done that, isn't that good? Look at the penance I've done. And your penance will not address your faults, it will bring about another fault, which is called pride. You know, if you do penance, and at the end of it feel pleased about it, you need to think about it. In some instances, it may be better if you've done nothing at all. I remember one year, about 10 years ago now, Lent had come along, and because of a serious operation that I had and complications, I had lost about one-fifth of my weight. And when I lose weight, I'm not a big man, it takes me ages to put it on. One of my friars, because my brothers in Carmel, you know, we talked to each other very honestly, came to me and said, look, I want to talk to you. I said, what, any time? I was the provincial then, it's about Lent. I said, oh yeah. And he said, this Lent, he said, I'm going to address my weaknesses by eating less. For goodness sake, for your leg, you must eat more. which was difficult too, but I accepted what he said as spoken to be in true love by one of my brothers in Carmel, and so I tried to eat more. Yeah? So you must pick. And even now, as we're getting towards a halfway mark, the point of Lent is not getting through 40 days. The point of Lent is doing something for your holiness. Indeed, preferably something which will not only change you, but will have an implication for your life, the rest of your life. And if something's worth doing in Lent, it's worth keeping up in some manner or form for the rest of your life. Because your weaknesses and your failings don't go away at Easter Sunday. Or maybe they do for you, but they certainly don't for me. Okay. That said, that finishes off last week, and we can now move to the third of the traditional components of Lent. Prayer, fasting, which I now call self-denial, which is thus linked with penance. And the third is almsgiving. And, you know, it's not about giving to the poor, because what if you are one of the poor? What do you do? Okay? What happens if you're... The poorest place I've ever been to is Madagascar, that island on the right-hand side of the African continent. No one had shoes. There were no street lights in the capital city. No traffic lights. Only street lights were on the road to the president's palace. But the people at night had battery-operated things or candles. Saw people moving house. They had their things on a cart. And they were pushing the car because vehicles, motorized vehicles, were very rare. And unless you were rich, you couldn't have a horse or a buffalo moving. You had to be out there barefooted pushing it yourself. So what do they make of almsgiving? They don't have it. Now, almsgiving, within the true context of the Christian life, is about love. Because they are the three essentials: prayer, denial of self, which I'll probably look at in more detail because I've only done it in passing next year. Because self-denial is one of the most important things in a spiritual life. And the third is love, which for Lent we speak of as almsgiving. Let's begin by trying to get a sense of what love is. You know, it's one of those things which priests talk about at Mass all the time. They talk about love and forgiveness, and, you know, that annoys me. Because I don't know what love is, nor do I know what forgiveness is. I know people have an inability to forgive, but I don't know what forgiveness is. I said today in the little homily, the closest I've got to it is it's an attitude and a state of heart. It's not something you can do, but when I'm talking about forgiveness. But love is one of those things. Everyone talks about love as if they know what it is. What is it? Oh, it's a Hollywood movie, that's what love is. What is love? And if we're truthful about it, have you ever loved in such a way that you're happy with the way you love? Take Christmas, for example, when everyone in preparation for Christmas is buying presents, preparing the dinner, and all these things. And come Christmas evening, it's one of the worst times in the year for arguments, fights, and all sorts of things. Because by Christmas evening, all the worst things seem to come out, not in every family, because we used to sit around and play cards on Christmas night. And eat. The Chinese have a simple way of doing things. If you're playing cards and eating, you haven't got time to say anything bad about anybody. You're too busy. When you're eating, you're chewing on something. So that's why the Chinese have food is so central in their culture. But you look at Christmas Day, all the effort that goes in, and yet, if you think about things, things tend to go wrong when you're trying to love. What happens at a wedding? Okay? To my mind, I find this very odd. big family arguments can happen at a wedding or after a funeral. And everyone thinks they know what love is. Ask you the question, what is love? Do you know how to love? And my sense is, I don't know how to love. You've got an inadequate bishop because he doesn't know how to love, and I will admit it. And, you know, what are examples of this? I can remember because from about 1992 all the way through until just a few years ago, I was involved with youth groups, sometimes very big youth groups that we had at our monastery, working with young people, largely university students. And I remember once two university students came to see me. They were both men. They were both Chinese. They were both studying medicine. And neither of them wanted to study medicine. One wanted to be an engineer. The other one wanted to be a motor mechanic. And they were desperately unhappy. Unfortunately, they were bright and they got the marks. And I said, well, why can't you do engineering? Why can't you be a motor mechanic? Because for the last 18, 19 years, all we've heard is our parents saying to us, we've given up this, 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 and this, so that you can go to school and be a doctor. And we can't. And as far as their parents were concerned, they were convinced that they did everything because they loved their sons. There's no question about it. They went without. All of this was to love their children. But the thing that had never crossed their mind is, well, what does your child want? It's a very common thing. It happens in marriages. It happens everywhere. People love in what way? They've worked out what love is. We all do it. And it means that a very common form of love, in fact, is self-love, is absolute selfishness. Because a person's doing it for love of somebody, but they have no idea, in fact, how they should love this person. The first thing to do is when I prepare people for baptism from that, you must ask God how to love your child, and ask God to teach you. Because you will only know how to love your child by knowing who your child is. With profound understanding of this child, without it, you won't know how to love. Because you'll love the way you think that child should be loved, and that may have nothing to do with what that child is. I'm just giving you these examples to begin by saying, what is love? And yet we hear about it. We priests are the most guilty of it. Because we talk as if we know what love is. We talk as if we know what forgiveness is. And I have no idea what either of them are. It doesn't mean that I can't talk about them, bore you to tears, but I don't know what they are. What I do know is when I've experienced something which is not love. What I do know is when I try to love and do things and the outcome has been that was not loving. And we all know what that is. To be driven to love where this is not love. In the same way that it's worse to be obsessive. And a person can be so overwhelmed by an obsession that what's happening in their mind is love, but it's not love because you look and see what happens inside you. Love will always lead to peace and gentleness in the one who loves. If the inner movement is not about peace, then be very careful that what you're doing, in fact, is something driven from something within yourself. But I think we can begin by saying that we do recognize something which is not love. That at least is a starting point, okay? Because the very simple truth is, love is not something that I do. It's not something that was in my power. Just as forgiveness, I think, is not something that I do. You know, when Jesus said, "Go, your sins are forgiven," and what did the scribes and Pharisees say? "Who is this man? Because God alone can forgive." Notice Jesus' response wasn't to justify himself, but to prove to you that the Son of Man has power to sin and say, "Get up, pick up your mat and walk." Okay? Jesus doesn't deny that God alone can forgive. The interesting thing about love is God alone loves. Because last week I told you from chapter 4 of the first letter of St. John. St. John says God is love. I told you the first letter. Because who God is the one who just loves. And who are we? What is a human being? The one who was made to receive love. Okay? First and foremost, a child, a baby, is not born to love, but to be loved. Isn't that true? From the first moment of the child's existence, which is why the church has its teaching on life, from the first moment of the child's existence, that they are coming into existence to be loved. You don't ask a fetus to love somebody. You don't ask a newborn babe to love someone. Everybody knows that this newborn child is there to be loved. Okay? And we think of love strangely from the perspective of, I have to love. But from the very beginning of life, we are born to be love. And that's a very important thing to keep in mind, because I must be loved in order to know how to love. I must receive love in order to love someone. Again, that's one of the tragedies of today. Also the tragedy of this Royal Commission stuff. That if a person has not received love, they will find it difficult to love. And any failing in love, in being loved, will be something that a person might be carrying and work through, because their ability to love is somehow less than what it should be. That said, everyone has had an experience in life which becomes an obstacle to their ability to love. It needn't be violent or abusive, but it's naturally what happens. So I don't think that a person has a natural ability to love perfectly. Because with a child, a misunderstanding is sufficient. Okay? Because the misunderstanding can be received by that child, and nobody knows. It can be twins in the same family, everyone's grown up the same thing, but they experience something negatively, and it has a negative impact. So there's no way that we can avoid this kind of thing which happens. I suppose in its own way, I believe it's one of the parts of growing up. It's a pity that some have to grow up and live in such great difficulty. There's a Latin saying, and it's a very important one. In Latin it goes this way: "Nemo dat quod non habet." It simply means no one gives what they don't have. And it's the very important truth about love. You love on the basis of the love that you have received. Well, there's a problem with that. And the problem is, you know, there are some of you who, as you look back, would say, and you won't say aloud, but you would say, something happened to me, or there was a disappointment, or something earlier in life. It need not have been in the family, it could have been anything. And because of that, I have a difficulty in loving. Okay. That's why, but we'll go on to put more meat on this in a moment. That's why the first two talks that I gave were so important in order that I could talk about love. Because fundamentally, no human being can love me perfectly. It's a simple truth. No parents can love their child perfectly, and no one should expect that they should have been loved perfectly. It's impossible. It's impossible for a mere human being to love with perfect love. And yet the strange thing is, perfect love is what I want. Now, I don't expect a perfect piece of toast. Okay, because I've noticed all toasters seem to toast one side more than the other. Have you noticed that? And you think to yourself, they put a man on the moon and they've sent things to Mars, and they could still can't make a toast of the toast even. I just arrived here and I've got this new toaster. I thought to myself, they become like toasters. I like that because we buy mean toasters, not very good ones. And I got this really good toaster they bought the bishop. I'm thinking, I'm going to get a great piece of toast. I put it in, cups up, and one side's toasted more than the other. There you go. That's the story of life. The perfect toaster just does not exist. Perfect anything doesn't exist in terms of how we're loved, and yet I want to be loved perfectly just as I'd like that of a perfect toaster. And that desire was put into me because it is the truest desire that I have, because only God can love perfectly. And that desire which is in everyone's heart is a desire which we'll look at next year, which is about God in my life and opens me to God. But we can at least go back to what we said in the first talk 2 weeks ago. I am called to prayer because in prayer I may experience the love of God. It's why prayer is so important in the Christian life. You know, there's been so much a focus recently on get out there and do this and do that, that's fine. But the problem with doing that is you empty yourself out. For me as a Carmelite, the beginning point is in so much as I know the love of God, so much can I love another person. Put it simply, as your bishop, insofar as I know the love of God, so far can I love my diocese. No further, nothing more. Because anything else, in fact, is being manufactured by me. You know what that's like. You know what it is to manufacture love. I know what that was when I was a young Carmelite student in Melbourne. For 2 years I used to have to go in every Friday and spend the whole Friday in St. Vincent's Hospital and do the rounds, and everyone was saying, isn't Brother Greg so wonderful? He's so loving, he's so kind. Every time I heard that, I would cringe. I'd go home feeling an absolute hypocrite. Those words were very nice that they were saying, but I knew they weren't true. Because I knew that I was there because my superior told me to be there. I was trying to be as good as I could, but it wasn't yet coming from my heart. And yet, I said all these nice things about this young brother who was in there doing these things. And it was like a sword in my soul when they said that. Because I felt like a hypocrite. I knew it wasn't true. Because you can only love with what little love you've got. Okay? And that's the first thing in terms of what we're talking about, why love is so important in the spiritual life and in the season of Lent. Because the whole purpose of Lent, in the end, is not to do things myself, it's not to perfect myself. The whole point of the Christian life is to receive the love of Christ, to be a recipient. Why? Because insofar as I have the love of Christ, I have love to give somebody else. Name of that quite no habit. If I don't have divine love, then what I'm giving you is a poor second or a poor third. And it's now even more important for me as your bishop to pray than it ever was when I was simply a Carmelite friar, because I know I need a lot, and I know I don't have it. And the only place I'm going to get it is from Jesus himself. Okay, I'll pause to see if you've got any questions, because now I have to move into something which is in fact more important and in fact rather interesting. So do you have any thoughts or questions? Stand up if you do, and don't be afraid. I'm the smallest person in this room, so if no one's okay. We have to move on because I've got some leftover rice to fry up tonight. And I'm sitting there waiting for it. St. John of the Cross, that I'm going to begin to talk about now and continue to talk about next week, extraordinary man. John of the Cross and Teresa of Avila and Jesus Christ are three close friends of mine. Love it. Kind of, before we go on, we'll look at it next week, but you need to know Jesus well. You need to know him as a friend. And any great person in terms of the spiritual life, it's not someone that you know in your head. You have to know who they are as a person. And this man that I'm going to start talking about, that I'll give you some biographical details about next week, it's the most remarkable man. And the great thing about the Carmelite saints, they're not like statues. They're actually very human. Now, just to say something, St. Teresa of Avila was a jealous woman, loved friends. People loved to be with her. She fell in love with the priest. Thank goodness the confessions were like what we have at our nuns here, little bars and spikes. And if you got too close to the person hearing confessions, you're banging it against a spike and it might go through your head. So, but she fell in love with the priest. And she recognized what was happening. That she recognized I may never go to him as a confessor again, because my friendship with him is coming between my friendship with Jesus Christ. That's what I mean by these people have to be friends in that very real sense. John the Cross was a remarkable man, a very human person. And I want to give you two of his sayings this evening about love to help you begin to see how it is that you're going to receive the love of Christ. Because I've given you something which is a great pious platitude. Go and sit down and pray, I said, and start to receive the love of Jesus. That took me more than 10 years praying every day as a Carmelite for the first step to happen. The second step happened after 20 years. Okay. And now it's 30-something years and I'm waiting for the next step to happen. But we'll see what happens. It's one of these things that I can say, and it sounds very nice and inspiring, but I need to give you some practical things to begin to see. I've already given you things on prayer, but I want to give you practical things about life which will help you. So John the Cross has a beautiful saying which I almost put on my ordination card. I forget what I put on my it seems so long ago, but there's a beautiful saying which goes like this. In the evening of life, you will be tested in love. Learn then to love as God wants to be loved, and stop acting in your own way. Beautiful. In the evening of life. That means as life starts to come to an end, you'll be tested in love. Beautiful. God's not going to come along and say, what did you do or what didn't you do? The simple question will be the question which is given in chapter 21 of St. John's Gospel. Simon, son of John, Jonah, do you love me? Okay. I was talking to Father Jim at lunch today, And we were saying, how useless Greek and Hebrew is, which is probably quite true, unless you're going to be a scripture scholar. And he said to me, I won't need it on the last day when I meet Jesus. And I said, not unless he speaks to you in Greek. then you'll be stuck. In the evening of life, the only question will be, do you love? Now the interesting thing, John the Cross has another saying. This is his complete works in this book. He has many wise sayings. The sayings were written because people would write to him, and he would write a reply, or he would be thinking about someone when he would see them, he's written a piece of paper with a little saying that he knew would help them. And one of the sayings, apart from this one on the evening of life, was this one. It's one that always worries me, What would you do if on the last day you stand before Jesus and tell him all the things you've done for him, and he says, yes, you've done all those things, but the one thing that I wanted you to do was the one thing you didn't do? That the difference between a self-driven love and a love which comes from the inspiration of God. You know, we can go and do so many things and you can tick them off. You know, I'm on this society, I've done that, I do this on Friday, I do this on Saturday. But if none of these is what he wants you to do, as good it might be, and as encouraged as you are by your parish priest who thinks, well, if he or she's not doing this, what am I going to do? But if none of these is what God wants you to do, John of the Cross will say, on the last day, what was the point of it? You were in fact doing it for yourself. For me, this is a terrifying, it doesn't terrify me, but it's something that I carry with me all the time, because I can never presume I'm doing God's will. Except if I'm doing something that I know that I have to do, but I don't want to do it, then I presume God must be in there somewhere. But it's that sense in which somehow I have to find a way to bring my life around to ensure that what I'm doing is what God wants and not what I want. Otherwise, he'll say, yeah, great. But you know, I only put you on earth to do this one thing. And it's the one thing you didn't do. Now the interesting thing is, I will probably never know why God put me on this earth, what it was I was sent to do, and I don't think he'll ever tell me, because I don't need to know. So in the evening of life, you'll be tested in love. Learn then to love how God wants to be loved. That's that thing about that other saying I gave you, which is a terrifying one. How do I learn to love God as God wants to be loved? Because it's like those parents. You know, the best thing for you is if you be a doctor. But it's the one thing you didn't want. And then I said, you have to talk to your parents if you don't either. Because you will be a bad doctor, because you'll be unhappy. And more to the point, someone else who really wants to be a doctor wants your place at university. You know, it's a terrible travesty of things. But the parents thought, this is love. Why? Because this is what I would have wanted for myself. But I never had the opportunity, because my parents were poor. I couldn't do this. So I'm going to work and work, and I'm going to give up things so that my son can be the doctor that I want him to be. I can assure you that at the very beginning I was the biggest disappointed in my family when I went up to be a cowboy, because I got to what they all thought was the best thing possible. But after they saw me, if I'd ever left the order, they would have been so upset, because they became very proud of me as a cowboy. But it's the way things are. You know, we love thinking the best, but we don't know. Learn to love as God wants to be loved. How can I learn to love God as God wants to be loved? Because without my knowing it, my loving always carries with it selfishness, to use a simple word. Because part of my loving is loving myself. How can I break out of that? So notice the first part at the end of the evening of life will be examined in love. Learn to love as God wants to be loved. Next line is the first hint. And stop acting in your own way of acting. Because the foundational thought is, I actually don't know how to love. For God's sake, don't let that paralyze you in such a way that you don't love anybody. You still have to go on living. But we live with that underlying humility that I don't know. Okay? I don't know. It's what the priests of this diocese are going to learn very quickly. Their bishop doesn't know. In fact, in many areas, doesn't have a clue. That's why I need my priest to help me to know what's the right thing. You know, we don't know. And he says, stop acting your own way of acting. Now we need to work out, how can I stop acting in my own way of acting and learn how to love as God wants to be loved? Are you with me? This is a very practical question. There's another saying he has, which I think it's in the second book of the Saint about Carl, but also in this book, where he says this wonderful saying. He says, if you look somewhere and don't find love, then you put love there. And then when you look there again, you'll find love there. It's a very simple, very practical thing. And I'll give it to you again. If you look somewhere and don't find love, put love there. And then when you look again, you'll find there is love there. The reason that this is such a practical saying is because generally when we look somewhere and don't find love, what do we do? We run away. Okay? It's a normal thing. If I look somewhere and don't find love, one person will run away, another person will become defensive, another person will become angry, another person will turn off. It's kind of, we go into our normal modes of survival when we're in a situation which we don't find as loving. When it is loving, it's wonderful. You know, it's very easy for me to, I'm settling in here because you're also loving. You know, you're so nice to me, I can't help but be nice. Okay? Try being nasty to me and see what happens. But because you're so nice, what would you do? That's what you do when someone's so nice. I went out to the casino, and Father Peter sent me this Cooper hat. And I never thought in my whole life I'd have something like that. And I think, of course, they're so nice. I have to be nice in return. That's not how I learned to love. Because Jesus says, you know, even the tax collectors and sinners do as much, don't they? So what have you got to boast about? You know, what have I got to boast about? Because there's nothing. The real crunch happens when I'm in a situation which is not loving. When everything starts to go wrong within me now. And you know what I mean. This could be a non-loving situation of a high order, in which case probably is better to run away. Or an unloving situation of a less severe order. And I would say, in terms of what I'm about to give you, you start with the easy things first. Never start with difficult things, because you'll fail and you might have to come back and try again. You start with simple things. That's why in Lent, start with simple things. Don't try with difficult things, because you just keep failing forever. The simple things are important because that's how we build up our spiritual strength. Okay? You know, a long, 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 long time ago, I learned to count for about 7 years. The problem is my fingers have got a bad memory. They don't know what to do anymore. But now, why am I talking about that? There was a reason. What was I talking about?
Yes,
you know, when you learn the piano, you start with easy things. They don't give you Chopin and Beethoven in the second week, because you give up. You know, you wouldn't know how to tackle it. But you start with easy things and slowly build up, and before you know it, you'll be better. Well, not before you know it, it takes a bit of time. But you will get there. And in these kind of things that I'm talking about now, whether it's learning to pray, whether it's self-denial, or in terms of learning how to love, you start with easy things and slowly build up your strength. The fool begins with hard things. Because if you begin with hard things, you presume that you're really strong and good. So I'm not presuming that you want to get it right, and then you probably will. Okay. So it says, where you don't find love, put love. Let me give you an example of that. I'll give you a simple one of my own life, not big ones. This was when I was a Carmelite novice. And I'd done my apostolacy. And for some reason, there was one of the novices who seemed to have it in for me. It doesn't matter what, you know. And I think, what am I going to do with this? I'm going to be living with this fella. In fact, he was a great man. But for some reason, I annoyed him. And you can do that. I probably annoyed half of you by that. But that's life. And I thought, well, I was a precarious. And novitiates, when I was a novice, were difficult. You know, it was so cold in our novitiate that when the novice master was there, we'd go over the oven and turn it on full blast and stand around it, just to try to be warm. But he became ill. And the novice master asked for someone to take him his meal to look after him. And I didn't like him very much because he didn't be very nice to me. And I decided that it wasn't safe. But no, okay, I'll do that. So I took him his meals and helped him in that. And thereafter, we became the closest of friends. That's what John Cross means. When you don't find love, put love. And then when you look there again, you will find love. Because it's kind of the way that it works, because the simple truth about life is, for me as a Carmelite, and this is what I understand as my vow of obedience. My vow of obedience is not a vow of who's on hold, but it's a vow in which I commit myself the rest of my life to learn how to love. Because of obedience is doing as you're told. Doing as you're told without love is not obedience. Doing as you're told demands love. Because otherwise it is obedience in name, but it's not obedience. If Jesus went to the cross, biting his teeth and saying, look, when I get to heaven, I'm going to strangle my father. You know, that would not have been what it's about. The whole point about what we're going to be coming to soon, in terms of the passion of Jesus, is it's not what happened to him. That's why I've never looked at the passion of Christ, that movie. There's no way that I would allow a Hollywood person to infiltrate my imagination and therefore my prayer for the whole time of the year. So I never will watch it. No interest. Because I've already got my way of praying into our Lord's passion and his death. And every year it moves on further. And it's so precious to me. There's no way that I will let someone else kind of affect my prayer. Not to say that you shouldn't, if your prayer is different to mine. But as he went to the cross, the whole point of it was not that the horrifying death, but that at every moment in his suffering, he loved. There they were tormenting him, and he loved them. There he was dying, and they were jerking, and he loved them. There were his apostles who ran away and didn't do anything to help him, and he loved them. There was Judas Iscariot, and he loved him. Because it was who Jesus was. And the power of his death is, it is the story of the absence of love And what we learn from it is, in the absence of love, we love. Okay? Carry it, otherwise you'll miss so much of what Holy Week is about. Holy Week is the greatest example of love. It's why it's why Christianity is true at the existential level. I'll just divert on that to explain what I mean. There was a great Japanese Carmelite who died 3 years ago called Augustine Ichiro Okumura. Paul VI put him on the Commission for Interreligious Dialogue. He was on for a long time. But his history was this. Ichiro in Japanese, I'm not Japanese, but Ichiro means number one. He was the first child, the eldest son, born into a Zen Buddhist family that had owned a sub-temple, one of those little temples in Kyoto. And he was to run the temple. Anyway, before the Second World War, he had already obtained, he obtained one doctorate before the Second World War, one afterwards. The one afterwards was from the Sorbonne in Paris. In Japan, he did one as well. I think in finance or something. But at the end of the war, his family said to him, Ichiro, you will have to go and study Christianity, because we are about to be overrun by Christians. At the end of the war, the Japanese, his family said. So he went and studied. He was considered at that stage to be a Zen Buddhist master. Okay? Which meant, in his words, I had acquired the emptiness of compassion. He goes and studies, and he starts to write a tome as to why Christianity is wrong. He said it's wrong because of its understanding of suffering. And the more he wrote, he eventually stopped, and he couldn't write any further. He was writing this for the Buddhists. He went to see his Zen Buddhist master and said, I'm struggling with this. Because the more I'm writing, the more I'm being convinced by Christianity. And in the end, his master said to him, now, I wonder whether any priest would do this. He said to him, Ichiro, you cannot continue this way until you have experienced Christianity. Would any of you priests say, look, John, you can't go on until you've experienced Islam, go from a Muslim or something, you know? The bishop would throw up his arms, what are you saying to our young people? But the Zen master said to him, no, for your own integrity, you're going to experience Christianity. So he went. He ended up being baptized as a Catholic and became a discussed Carmelite. And when I met him, he was a provincial in Japan. A remarkable man. The man who struck me simply because of his sheer kindness. I'll give you an example. I was staying in the house in Rokujizo, in Uji, just outside of Kyoto. And after the meeting, I wasn't provincial then. The provincial in Australia said, well, you stay a few days, because being Chinese, you're some Japanese things. So I stayed a week, and I would take, because I can speak a little bit of Japanese and can read a bit, I would take the train into the city. And I'd always come back, and I didn't have much money, but I'd buy something for the community, some cakes or some bread or something, not much, because I couldn't afford much. And he came to me after 3 days and said, look, please don't insult me. I'm thinking, what have I done? I'm sorry, Father, you know, I was a young priest. He said, I've noticed you going out every day, and when you come home, you never have anything for yourself, you always buy something for us. Please accept this from me. You can buy something for yourself, or if you don't want to buy something for your parents. And he gave me this stack of money. You know, suddenly, for me, a poor Carmelite, I wasn't rich, but I had more money than I needed. I was able to buy things for my parents. But he was an extraordinary man. Just watching and thinking, no, I have to go out and reach out to this young friar. He had love. Now, I speak to you about him because over the years I had many conversations with him until he got outside. And I asked him, I said, amongst many questions, what was the difference for you between Zen Buddhism and Christianity? He said, they're radically different. There's no continuity between them, even though some of the techniques might be similar. He said, because as a Zen Buddhist, I had achieved true emptiness. But now, as a discussed karma life with Jesus, my emptiness is filled with the love of Christ. And I would never go back to emptiness because of what I have. That's that sense that the form of life, of prayer, of self-denial, and of putting love where you don't find love, is so that you will receive love. Okay? And only in receiving that love will you then be able to love in the Christian sense of the word. So we go back. Where you don't find love, put love. And then you'll find it. What in fact is happening here? Because as I discussed with this beautiful man, our lives, for me as a Carmelite at least, and it remains the case, is my obedience is an obedience to learn to love. And how do I learn to love? Because I don't know how to love. That's why being in situations which are not loving are in their own way so significant in the spiritual life. I'm talking about easy ones at first, not difficult ones. I find this not loving, and yet God loves this. Okay? For me, there seems to be the absence of love, and yet that has to be a falsehood. And it goes to Auschwitz. We might talk about Auschwitz next week. It's the most horrible thing we can think of. You know, the last 100 years have been full of horrible revelations from all over the world. And we know even from within our own country. But we look at something like Auschwitz and Birkenau thinking, isn't that dreadful? And yet Auschwitz and Birkenau produce saints. Their presence in Auschwitz and Birkenau, someone like Edith Stein, one of my own saints, her presence there brought God to other people. She was in a situation we might talk about in the next week, which was terrifyingly horrible. But she always knew that she would be in Auschwitz one day. After Kristallnacht, 1936, when the Nazis went through and broke the crystal in the synagogues and burnt the synagogues, she was in the Carmel of Cologne, and she started to pray then that her life would be for those who were suffering. And she knew that she would die in a concentration camp. She knew that. And her life from then until 1945 was a preparation for this. Because what she was doing in that experience was she was putting love where there wasn't love, in such a way that when she went to Auschwitz, she was able to love. She tended to children. She tried to console, you know, women who were besides themselves, and that would have been the most natural thing, you know. Have you ever been to Birkenau? I'll tell you about it next week. It is horrible. And she, in this preparation, was being prepared for where she knew she would be going. She didn't know which one, for the concentration camp. Because in that concentration camp, she was love. And she put love into these situations where anyone would say there's no love there. Okay? That's why she's a saint. And there are others there. So who's the fellow who wrote that book? Coming next week, because I was going to talk about that. And that's what I mean by where you don't find love quick enough. Because where you don't find love, perhaps another person will find love. But only in small things at first, because where you don't find love speaks heaps about who you are. It's almost as if God has personally crafted your life so that in these small ways, it's up with the small things, you don't find love. I guarantee that another person wouldn't find it problematic at all. So that you don't find love is about you. And what it's doing, John the Cross would say, is now Jesus is saying to you, now is the beginning of your first lesson in learning how to love. That's how it happens in life. I don't know. That's why I want to run away. It's why I become defensive. It's why I become angry. It's why I become whatever it is. Because what's happening is this real life situation, one in which I don't know how to love. And Jesus says, learn how to love by loving, by putting love there. And if you don't know how to do it, go away and pray about it. It's the way these things come together, because by loving in this situation, you will be denying yourself. Okay? By the act of love, self-denial comes into action. And that then is self-denial, which is real, as opposed to, I think I'll do this. Well, how do you know whether God wants you to do that? You want to do it. But if it's not what God wants, I promise you it will succeed in nothing. But when you don't have love, it's got to do with you, the way God made you, what we looked at last week. Go away and pray about it and begin to deny yourself in love. When that happens, in fact, Jesus is teaching you how to love. And notice, going back to the first thing about John the Cross, to do that, you have to stop acting in your own way of acting. And when you start to do that, you'll be learning to love as God wants to be loved. Now, this, in fact, I believe is a lifelong task. It's something which we have to work on slowly. And don't be afraid when you get it wrong, when you don't succeed. That's when you have to be as cunning as can be. And the cunning is something which you have to address to yourself. It's not about cunning by which you avoid things or you manipulate or take advantage. Jesus doesn't mean that at all. The cunning, most of all, is something which I apply to myself, because I have to work out the way to love where I don't know how to love, to go against myself, to deny myself. And notice why this is so important. Because now this is real penance. This is real self-denial, because it has a point, it has a purpose. And the purpose is, by doing this, not only do I learn to love, but in addressing my own faults with prayer, I'm now beginning to walk the path of holiness. That quite simply is what Lent is about. Okay? This is the time where I normally stop to see if you have any questions or comments. Because if you haven't got any, I think you haven't been listening to me. Any thoughts or questions, please? Yes?
You know, I consider it like love is not in the emotion, but I always used to say love is in the will. Would you say that is?
That is absolutely correct. Let me say what we said. What's your name?
Chris.
Chris said, love is not in the emotion, love is in the will. And that's, you should go and read John the Cross, because of what John the Cross says. Absolutely correct.
I've tried, but it's a bit hard.
Oh, that's okay with me here. You'll have someone to help you. Love is not a feeling, okay? Because when Jesus died on the cross, the last thing he was feeling was love. My God, why have you forsaken me? He felt absolutely abandoned, all by himself. This was not a good thing. And yet, he simply did the loving thing. And love is something. It's something that I do live. It's a way of living. It's to use the traditional medieval thing, it's an act of the will, as you say, which is correct. You love, not because you say you love, but you show your love by what you do. Isn't it? But we all say that. You show your love by what you do. There was my mum. We all had the flu. Too sick to want to do anything, but people needed to eat. And she was as sick as can be, but she was in the kitchen cooking. She was feeling sick, not love. But what she was doing proved that she loved. Because she did it because she loved. And notice, and therefore we have to be very careful. Not next in every year after that, giving a hint of where it will be, so you just keep at it. We will look at the relationship between faith and love. Very important. And other thoughts or questions? Out the back, if you've heard me, you must have a question. Answer. I can see your head way at the back in the last row.
You're saying that if we can't find love or give love, to go away and pray about it. Or do you mean
you're going to
say that
it's real? No, but I would say, well, it depends how you pray, but it's always good to reflect on your own inadequacies in prayer. Because when you do that, you'll understand and you understand yourself better. So something happens and it's annoying you and that. Okay, you might better put love there now, but take it to God in prayer. Experience in prayer what you felt when this happened, and place it in God's hands. Don't even talk about it, but allow that to interrupt your silence, and be there with God, and in time, you will begin to see. These things kind of that I'm giving you this evening are not going to happen just like that one after another. As I said to you, I was lucky. After 3 years, I knew for sure that God wanted me to become a monk. From that moment, I never had a doubt about my vocation, but my path of prayer. 10 years, something happened. 20 years, something happened. And all bits and pieces happen here and there in prayer, but it's not something that you can just sit down and learn. And so, part of what I'm proposing for all of you is to embark on the path of prayer. And at this stage, all I can say is ask you the right question and I might give you the right answer. Because we're doing kind of introductory things at the moment. But yes, go away and just spend some time with God. Yes.
When Jesus said, "Our Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," I personally have a great sense that he did have a motion, and that motion was love.
Yes, yes.
That's different from when he said to the Father, "Why have you abandoned me?" That was faith, different from love.
Yes.
But I think he was really feeling love.
Yes.
Otherwise, doing the right thing is kind of duty.
Yes. Although love is greatest when there's no feeling. When there is feeling, it's easier to love. And the test of true love is like my mother. She must have loved me, otherwise she wouldn't be in there cooking. Otherwise she would have stayed in bed. And in the end, when Jesus died, it was sheer faith. And when it's sheer faith, it is perfect love. When there's something in it for me, it's not to say it's not love, but the more perfect love is there when there's nothing in it other than it's when I believe. It's what Saint Therese speaks about. We might mention her in the last talk, in what we call Manuscript C of her autobiography, The Story of the Soul. And she says this, things were so hard that I didn't even know whether I believed in God. And she said, I didn't even believe in heaven, but I wished, I wanted there to be a heaven, I wanted there to be a God. And she said, in myself, there was nothing that I believed in which I thought I believed. It's a terrible thing, but this is the great little flower. And she said, in that darkness of faith, all I knew I could do was to love as if that was everything. She said, when there was no emotions, nothing there, not even a sense that I believed, she said, I resolved to do the works of faith in dryness. That's getting close to perfect love. Because the only thing that could make it possible to take was love, real love from God.
You talked about almsgiving at the beginning. If I give alms, only what I can afford, because it's not going to affect my lifestyle, I've got $100 I don't really need, I'll give them that. You said about where there's no love, give love and it'll come back to you. Is that possible that way? Well, I'm just talking about it might be a selfish motive.
The answer is, if you give love, love will always come back to you. Yet, as part of almsgiving, recognize that you're doing it for a purpose in yourself, not simply to give. So give alms, yes, that's a good thing. But also there needs to be loving action which is done on account of something that you find within yourself, which could go like this. I was going to go and buy this for myself this week, but I recognise this fault in myself and I won't go and get it. There's a penance and I'll give it away. Notice what happens. You're still giving something, but you're connecting the giving to something in yourself. I'll give you an example of giving and getting back. When I was a student in Melbourne, our pocket money each week was $4.60, and the return train fare to the city was about $3, which would leave you with $1.60. And all I wanted to do when I was done was go and buy myself a bowl of noodles, Chinese, and I'd save and save and save week after week until I had enough piece of bowl of noodles, which was about $7. So I took the train. I was so happy I was going to go down to Chinatown, get myself some noodles. And this poor girl comes along and says, well, please help me, sir. I've just lost all my money and I can't get home. I felt so sorry when I had to. So I gave her $5. And bought my $5 note, which would have left me $3. I thought, oh, I'm going to let you know. There we go, sir. And then I noticed she was doing it to everybody. She was collecting that. Just myself. I've been had, so I just walked along thinking about the noodles that I could have had. And I looked down on the ground and look, guess what I saw? A $10 note. So I picked it up and I was like, oh, thank you, God. So it can happen like that too. So, any other thought or question? Okay. Well, thank you very much. And all being well, we'll see you next week. When we're moving on now to practical things which you can use to help you in trying to get these three things together: prayer, self-denial, and love. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.